Vector Borne Disease Control Program, it's called known as NVBDCP. Now the Directorate of National Vector Borne Disease Control Program is the national nodal agency for prevention and control of major vector borne diseases that are of public health importance to us. And namely, those diseases are malaria, filaria, Japanese encephalitis, kalazar, dengue, and chikungunya. Although yellow fever is a vector borne disease, but it's not a part of the NVBDCP as such. So here are the various vector borne diseases that are a part of the NVBDCP. But then we just have to discuss about malaria. So as you can see, the reservoir for infection malaria is human. The causative agent is Plasmodium species, as you all know. And the various vectors are the anopheline mosquitoes and the various species of that. Now the vision of this National Vector Borne Disease Control Program is to have a well-informed and self-sustained healthy India free from vector borne diseases with equitable access to quality healthcare. And the mission is to have an integrated and accelerated action towards reducing mortality on account of malaria, dengue, Japanese encephalitis by half, and then elimination of malaria, kalazar by 2010, and then elimination of lymphatic filariasis by 2015. These were the mission that were incorporated when NVBDCP was first started in 2003 and 2004. Hence, you see the years 2010 and 2015. Coming on to the targets for the NVBDCP, under this program, for the malaria, the target is to eliminate malaria disease by 2030 in a phased manner. And we all know malaria is epidemic prone. So the target is to have zero indigenous cases, that is zero cases coming out of India, coming out of the population that is currently staying in India. We have to achieve that by 2030. In a phased manner, obviously, we'll talk about that later. And the three-pronged strategies are for the NVBDCP are of course, the disease management. As such, who are the patients, we have to manage them. And then there's the integrated vector management and the supportive interventions. So, why do we need to address these vector borne diseases? Now we'll see the disease burden of malaria. Globally, we'll look at the global burden. Now, according to the World Malaria Report that was released in 2020, there were around 200 million cases of malaria were reported in 2019, and similarly in 2018. And the number of malaria deaths were like over 4 lakh deaths in 2019, and similarly 4 lakh deaths were also reported in the previous year, that is 2018. And in 2019, 6 countries accounted for approximately half of all malaria deaths worldwide, that is Nigeria, accounting for 23% of them, Democratic Republic of the Congo, United Republic of Tanzania, Burkina Faso, Mozambique, and Niger. And as we all know, that children under 5 years of age are the most vulnerable group that is affected by malaria. In 2019 only, they accounted for 67% of all the malaria deaths worldwide. So yes, it's a big problem globally too. Now coming on to the Southeast Asia region, you can see that around 1.6 billion people were affected or were at risk of malaria in the Southeast Asian region as per the 2018 year. And over 7.5 lakh malaria cases were reported from this region. And over 160 malaria deaths were also reported during this time period from this particular region. Now coming on to the disease burden in India, according to the same World Malaria Report 2020, India represents 3% of the global malaria burden. That is, 3% of all the cases in the world accounted for by India. Despite being the highest malaria burden country of the Southeast Asia region, India showed a reduction in reported malaria cases of 49% and a reduction in the deaths of 50% compared with 2017. So as we can see, we have made a considerable improvement. Now also, India has made remarkable progress during the recent years in reducing the malaria incidence. Now, coming on to the how this National Vector Borne Disease Control Program, how it came into being and what's the history about this program. The first program that came into being in India was the National Malaria Control Program that was launched in 1953. It aimed at bringing down malaria transmission to a level at which it would cease to be a public health problem Thereafter, achievement was to be maintained by each state to hold down the malaria transmission at lower level indefinitely. As with any other program, it had certain strengths and certain weaknesses. Strength was that it was a whole new initiative to control malaria in a structured manner, and also it controlled cases and deaths significantly in our country. But in the weaknesses were like mainly adult vectors were targeted, and the treatment for patients attending institutions only those patients were catered who were reporting to the healthcare institutions with malaria. Now after this, we saw that globally a malaria eradication program was started by World Health Organization, and along those lines, National Malaria Eradication Program was started in 1958 in our country also. And then the objective of this program was to eradicate malaria in coming seven to nine years. The impact was that we could see a spectacular reduction in cases, and no deaths were reported in that year. Although there were certain challenges like financial challenges, logistical challenges, administrative and technical constraints, and then no special attention was given to the urban areas. And also we were seeing that there was a high resistance that was being developed against diphenyl trichloroethane, that is DDT. Now, after that, since in 1958, National Malaria Eradication Program was launched. And then in the 1970, a health committee known as MADOC committee, it reported that out of the total cases in India, 10 to 12% of those cases are contributed by the urban areas. So, and also we saw in the previous slides that that eradication program did not cater to the cases from the urban areas. So keeping in mind all that, urban malaria scheme was launched in 1971. Now under this urban malaria scheme, special intervention in selected high burden urban areas was given, and they were selected on the basis of those less road. Now all the urban areas were selected while the population was more than 50,000. And the annual parasite incidence was greater than or equal to 2. Slight positivity rate is greater than or equal to 5%. And I presume you all know about what is annual parasite incidence and slight positivity rate, as we were discussing in the previous class. Now the towns were selected to strictly implement civic bylaws to eliminate or prevent breeding places. Now, the strength for this urban malaria scheme was that it was the first initiative that focused on the cases in the urban areas too. Although the weaknesses were like in 1973, we started noticing resistance toward chloroquine also. And then by 1976, we saw that there was a massive resurgence of malaria, mainly due to the drug resistance. Now, see, as you can see, after that urban malaria scheme and then malaria eradication program, we saw that in 1976, there was a resurgence in the malaria cases. As you can see, we saw like more than 6.5 million cases in India alone. So that's why we had to modify our plans. That's why a modified plan of operation was started in 1977. Now the part of this modified plan of operation was to elimination of deaths due to malaria, and then reduction of malaria morbidity, and also to maintain the gains that were achieved till present, so that we can stop the further transmissions. Main features of this modified plan of operation was surveillance mechanism was put in place. The malaria clinics were started where you can get tested and where we could provide treatment to the beneficiaries. And also drug distribution centers was given who were asked to give a presumptive treatment based on the symptoms of the patient. And also fever treatment depots were started under this modified plan of operation. After this modified plan of operation in 1977, we started an enhanced malaria control project in 1997. And then similarly along those lines, National Anti-Malaria Program, NAMP, was started in 1999. Now this enhanced malaria control project in 1997 that was started. Yeah, so in order to combat malaria in high transmission areas of the country, and an enhanced malaria control project was launched with additional support from the World Bank in 1997. In 2003, it expanded to cover 200 PHCs, and then it was extended up to March 2005. Now, selection of PHCs under this enhanced malaria control project was based on the, again, annual parasite incidence that should be more than 2 for last 3 years, or the Plasmodium falciparum cases, more than 30% of all the malaria cases, or if the 25% population that is catered to by PHC is lives in tribal areas, those were also included. So now after that, National Anti-Malaria Program in 1999, finally including all the other diseases that are included, other vector-borne disease, National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program, that is the NVVDCP, was started as we know today in 2003 and 2004. Here are certain achievements and certain changes that were made to the NVVDCP. As you can see, in 2003, it was started, like Directorate of National Anti-Malaria Program, it becomes the Directorate of National Vector-Borne Disease Control Program. Then in 2005, we started with rapid diagnostic test for Plasmodium falciparum detection. And in that same year, it was integrated with the National Rural Health Mission. In 2006, we introduced artemisinin-based combined therapy. And then we also introduced this rapid diagnostic test to be used at the community level by the ASHAs and the ANNs. In 2019, we introduced long-lasting insecticidal nets. 2012, bivalent rapid diagnostic tests were made available, and then in 2013, we had a new drug policy. After that, a strategic plan for malaria control in India, 2012 and 2017, it was started, hardly no one is going to ask you that in your questions, as far as your exams for this third year are concerned. We will be studying about the latest strategic plan, the latest strategic plan that is being followed. This one is the older plan. The objectives for this plan was to decrease malaria burden and move towards pre-elimination stage, and to achieve by the end of 2017 an annual parasite incidence of less than 1 per 1,000 population. Scaling up of malaria control interventions with a focus on high burden areas and categorized strategic interventions. The outcome indicators for the strategic plan was that at least 80% of those suffering from malaria will get correct, affordable and appropriate, and as well as complete treatment within 24 hours of reporting. And to achieve at least 80% of those at high risk of malaria, to be that they get protected by effective preventive measures such as the insecticide-treated bed nets or the LLINs or the indoor digital space. And at least 20% of the population in high-risk areas is surveyed annually. That is, the annual blood examination rate should be more than 10%. Those are the outcome indicators for the strategic plan that was introduced in 2012 to 2017. Now, the strengths of this strategic plan was that was along the lines of the Millennium Development Goal that was achieved globally in India. So the API reduced from 2.09 in 2002, it came down to 0.92 in 2015. Bivalent rapid diagnostic tests were introduced, scaling up of LLINs, and then integrated vector management was also introduced in there. Now, the weaknesses of this strategy plan was that rapid diagnostic tests that were introduced, they were yet to be expanded to all the villages, and also there was a delay in conducting microscopic examinations of smears collected at community level. Then there was some difficulty that was noted in distribution of LLINs in remote areas with inhibited access in disturbed areas. Also, there was a deficiency of human resources at all levels, and then obviously there was an increase in the insecticide of resistance. So now coming on to the final thing that is quite important for the exam point of view also, that after this strategic plan for malaria control in India 2012 to 2017, there was this WHO Global Technical Strategy for Malaria, and the Asia Pacific leaders, they all sat together and they brought about certain strategic plans. And then along those lines, National Framework for Malaria Elimination in India was started in 2016, to be completed in 2030. And this is the thing that you need to understand, and then you need to learn all about this, because this is the thing that might come into your question, your exam, as a short note or a long note. So if you were not listening till now, I request you please be a little more attentive now. So the National Framework for Malaria Elimination in India 2016 to 2030, the vision is to eliminate malaria nationally and contribute to improved health, quality of life and alleviation of poverty. And the goals were to eliminate malaria, that is zero indigenous cases throughout the country by 2030, and to maintain a malaria-free status in the areas where malaria transmission has been interrupted, and then prevent reintroduction of malaria in those areas. Now, as we also that was introduced in a phased manner, certain achievements will be made by certain year, by certain time period. And we can see that by the end of 2016, all the states and union territories, they had included malaria elimination in their rural health policies and planning frameworks. So like all by 2016, all the states had adopted this national strategic framework. And then the target was that by 2020, transmission of malaria to be interrupted and zero indigenous cases and deaths due to malaria attained in all 15 states or union territories that were under category one, that is the elimination phase by 2014. We'll be studying about these categories, how the states were categorized into all these categories in the later slides. And then in the all, there were 11 states and union territories that fell into the category two, that is the re-elimination phase. And then we had this target to enter those states into the category one phase, upscaling of those certain states and union territories. And then five states that were under category three, that we intensified control phase. And then those states were supposed to enter into category two by 2020. Now, again, these are again by 2020, these five states and union territories that were under category three in 2014. We have to reduce malaria transmission, but then who showed malaria transmission in them or a reduction in the malaria transmission, but they continue to remain in the category three state. And then again, an estimated reduction in malaria of 15 to 20% at the national level compared to 2014. So like we expected a reduction of 15 to 20% from 2014 to 2020. And additionally, producing states with strong health systems such as Gujarat, Maharashtra, and Karnataka, they may implement accelerated malaria elimination programs to achieve interruption of transmission and demonstrate early elimination followed by sustenance of zero indigenous cases. There were certain states who were already doing pretty good as far as controlling the malaria cases were concerned. So yes, those states they could move on to the further strategies. Now by 2022. Again, as we saw, it has to be achieved in phases. We saw about 2016 that all the states had adopted. 2020, we again saw like a few targets. Then by 2022, these are certain targets, that is to reduce the transmission of malaria, to interrupt the transmission of malaria and zero indigenous cases and deaths due to malaria attained in all 26 states or union territories that were under categories 1 and 2 in 2014. So like we were expecting like in 2014 and 2016, we graded all the states, we categorized them into certain categories based on the annual parasite incidence in those states. So we categorized them into 0, 1, 2, and 3 based on the annual parasite incidence of them. And then by 2020, we had this target that we could, upscale like each state's category. Like if you are in category 3, like we wanted them to move on to category 2. So by 2022, we had this target that all those 26 states that were under category 1 and category 2, so we wanted to interruption of transmission of malaria in those states and zero indigenous cases by 2022. And also, that five states or union territories which were under category 3, that is intensified control phase, we wanted to enter into elimination phase, and also to, if possible, they could enter into pre-elimination phase also. And also an estimated reduction in malaria of 30 to 35% at the national level compared with 2014. So in 2020, we wanted an estimated reduction of 15 to 20%, whereas in 2022 we are estimating a reduction in malaria of 30 to 35%. This is at the national level. Then again, by 2024, we are expecting that we are hoping that all states and union territories and their respective districts reduce annual parasite incidence of less than one case per thousand population at risk, and sustain zero deaths due to malaria while maintaining fully functional malaria surveillance to track, investigate, and respond to each case throughout the country. Then to transmission of malaria to be interrupted and zero indigenous cases and deaths due to malaria attained in all 31 checks and unit territories. So through this program, we are expecting, or rather we are targeting that transmission of malaria is completely interrupted, and then to have zero indigenous cases, that is the cases that are coming out of, you know, the people who are currently residing in India. So we are expecting that by 2024 we can, you know, eliminate all that in all the 31 states and union territories. Whereas five states and union territories which are under category 3 in 2014 to enter into elimination phase. And then by 2027, we are targeting a complete interruption in the indigenous transmission of malaria. And then by 2030, after we have, you know, we have stopped the transmission of the vectors and we have, you know, managed the patients very well, then we want to, you know, prevent the re-establishment, or we don't want malaria to be reintroduced in those districts or in those states that have, you know, already achieved interruption in the transmission. So by 2030, we have to reduce the re-establishment of local transmission prevented in areas where malaria has been eliminated, and then malaria-free status maintained throughout the nation, and also to if everything goes as per the plan, as per the, you know, targets, India will be, you know, initiating the process of WHO certification for malaria elimination. Now, coming on to this national framework for malaria elimination, then the components of this strategic framework was strategic approaches, also surveillance mechanism, integrated vector management, epidemic preparedness, monitoring and evaluation, and then finally behavior change formulation. They are the certain components, and I'll be studying about each one of them in further slides. Now the strategic approaches, you can see, are the program phasing. We also in the previous slides, how the program is phased and how we are targeting, you know, every state and every district. And then the focus was to maintain on high endemic areas and the tribal population. And we saw that district was to be taken as the unit of planning and implementation. So all the planning and all the implementation that has to be done, it is supposed to be done, you know, at the district level. Each and every district will be making their own planning cycle, and then planning strategies, and implementation strategies. And then also there was a provision for special strategy for plasmodium vivax elimination. Then the ground phasing, and also like why phasing was needed, because it's natural that various states and union territories have different levels of malaria burden, and some low burden states are in a position to plan action for malaria elimination right now. I hope we are doing is clear about these concepts of elimination and eradication. So like, the high burden states will need to reduce the malaria burden before proceeding towards elimination. Now, categorizing those categories that I was talking about in the previous slides, this categorization was done on the basis of their annual parasite incidence as primary criterion, with due consideration given to the annual blood examination rate and this positivity rate as the secondary criteria. So here are the categorization. You can see that category is zero. Let's start with category 3. Category 3 are the states which are the worst performing states in as far as malaria is concerned. So the category 3, it included the states and unit territories which showed an annual parasite incidence of one or more than one. So like 10, we had the 10 states under this category 3, and the states that fell into this category 3, they needed an intensified control phase, control. the activities for controlling this malaria were to be intensified in these states, in category 3 states. And then coming on to the category 2 states, which are into the pre-elimination phase and before the elimination, and it constituted the states and unit territories that had annual parasite incidence of less than one, but then some of their districts were reporting annual parasite incidence of more than one. So 11 states were identified. And then category one, the states and union territories that are into the elimination phase, and they showed API less than one, and all the districts also they showed API less than one. 15 such states and union territories were reported. Then category zero, which needed, you know, which have already achieved elimination, and then the prevention of re-establishment phase was to be done in those states or districts. And then sadly and unfortunately, currently there is no state on union territory that is in the category zero. So like no state has achieved status of elimination as far as small area is concerned. So now interventions for the category one phase. In category one states, that is the elimination phase. This one. So Delhi is also a part of in this category one, with annual parasite incidence of 0.03. So the interventions that were to be carried out in the category one states and union territories are interrupting local transmission, null active foci of malaria, mandatory notification of each case of malaria from private sector as well as other sectors wherever malaria case is being reported. So it is mandatory to report those cases to the higher authorities, to the concerned authorities, and also the investigation and classification of all foci of malaria, strict total coverage of all active foci by active control measures. And then state and national level malaria elimination database was established, and it is to be made operational. Then implementation of interventions for effective screening, management, and prevention of malaria among mobile and migrant populations. Then also in these states, in category one states, setting up of national level reference laboratory was to be done. Then, although we don't have any state or union territory in the category zero, but still in future anyone falls into this category. So the interventions to be followed in the category zero states are to detect and prevent any reintroduced case by thorough screening and surveillance. The interventions that are to be carried out in the category two states, those are in the pre-elimination phase. Those are those states which are close to entering the elimination phase. You all might be knowing, because we go into the control phase, where where we say that this disease, although the disease is still present, but it ceases to be a public health problem as such. Like we can manage that much amount of cases through our locally available resources or like already available resources, we can easily manage that. In that case, we can say that particular disease has been controlled in that particular area. After that comes the elimination phase and then the eradication phase. So therefore, now coming back to slides, and therefore malaria elimination interventions will be introduced with particular focus on initiating elimination phase activities. Those districts where the API has been reduced to less than one case per thousand population at risk per year. And also these planning of implement elimination measures will be based on epidemiological investigation and classification of each malaria case focus. Test, treat, and track. First of all, test all of those, to come with symptoms of which are similar to malaria, and then treat them, all those test positive, and then track all those who are at high risk or those who are in susceptible individuals. Now coming on to the interventions for the category three states, which need intensified control phase. We are not still able to control them. The magnitude of this malaria problem is still very large. So here the interventions required are, we have to massive scaling of the resources, the timely referral and treatment needs to be done, to strengthen all the hospitals, all the healthcare facilities that are available in the particular state or the union territory. And then equipping all health institutions, this primary healthcare level and above, especially in the high risk areas, with microscopic facilities and rapid diagnostic tests for emergency use and injectable artemisinin derivatives for treatment of severe malaria. So these interventions, you don't necessarily have to, mug up them. Like if you clearly understand the concept of control, elimination, and eradication, things will be easier to remember what our activities are to be done in certain category. Like as you can see in the category three state, they still need them, they are still not achieving the elimination state. So they are still in the control phase. So we have to intensify all those activities that are required to control. As you can see, also there's a provision for establishment of a robust supply chain management system, and special focus was to be given on high-risk areas. Coming that focus on high endemic areas in the tribal population. So as you can see that most of the malaria cases in India were reported from Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Odisha, Telangana, and Tripura. And then high incidence in these states is particularly noted in the tribal population that is living in the foothills, forested areas, or the conflict affected areas. This malaria program tends to rapidly scale up interventions in these areas, along with innovative strategies and strong partnerships to speedily reduce malaria mortality and prevention. Now, this tribal malaria action plan. First of all, why it was needed? Pretty easy to understand and presume why tribal malaria action plan was needed. Because first of all, it's an inaccessible area, the high malaria burden. Mobility morbidity pattern and mortality pattern is also high. There's inadequate clothing, forest malaria, it's a quite tricky one to manage. And then there's also the practice of sleeping outdoors in these areas. Also, there is a decreased train manpower for these hard to reach areas. Now, this tribal malaria action plan. Special interventions for high-risk groups, such as tribal populations and populations that are residing in conflict-affected or hard-to-reach areas. One-stop centers or mobile clinics on fixed days in tribal conflict-affected areas to provide malaria diagnosis and treatment. Hamlet-wise ASHA instead of village-wise ASHA. And there's, this hamlet, it's a little smaller than a village. Where a group of, there's a cluster of houses that are residing in a particular group in a particular area. And then another cluster of houses are residing in a certain part of area. So they're called hamlet. So the concept of hamlet-wise ASHA was included in this tribal malaria action plan instead of village-wise ASHA that is in place in every other place of this country. Again, interstate collaboration was needed so as to provide a border surveillance. Also, the volunteer involvement, as we saw, there was a required need for trained manpower in these areas. Now, certain special groups and situations where these activities are needed, like forest regions, forest fringe areas, project areas, then urban and peri-urban areas. Cross-border malaria, floods and droughts, malaria in tribal areas. So these are the certain situations in groups, which needs special mention and which needs special guidelines and treatment for management. And we also like in the program, we also the district was to be kept as the unit for planning and the implementation for. All the malaria-related activities in that particular state. So why it was needed? Because the states and union territories, they were meant to address the district so that even if the given state or union territory is not yet in the elimination phase, the districts with annual parasite incidence less than one could be considered eligible for initiating elimination phase activities. And so that we resource allocation can be useful. So in a certain state, supposing in Delhi, if we see like we have 11 districts. So if we see like all 10 districts, they are not doing as good as far as malaria activities are concerned. But then there is only one district who has achieved whose annual parasite incidence is less than one, and they are moving towards the elimination phase. That's why it was so that particular district they can make their own plan, and then they can all start their elimination phase activities. Now we also that how this integration was done. Each district may subcategorize its blocks into different phases based on their API, and further each block into PHCs, PHCs into subcenters, and subcenters into villages. So like at every level we can categorize based on the API so that that particular block or that particular village or that particular subcenter, they may start their activities based on their particular annual parasite incidence. and not according to the district or the state level APIs. Now this district was supposed to carry out the stratification in October, and then states, you know, should compile district wise stratification by November. This is to be done each year, and then Directorate of NVBDCP should prepare state wise stratification by the month of December every year. Now this let's see why special strategy was needed for plasmodium vivax elimination. Because first of all, India accounts for more than 50% of the estimated plasmodium vivax cases in the world. And then plasmodium, we all know that plasmodium vivax show this formula of hypnozoids, you know, which can lead to relapse of malaria. So it prolongs the parasite's lifespan, and then, you know, they are difficult to detect once they turn into hypnozoids. And then the rapid diagnostic tests that are currently available to detect plasmodium vivax, they are less sensitive than the rapid diagnostic tests that are available for plasmodium falciparum detection. So that's why we again need a special strategy for plasmodium vivax. And then the radical treatment for plasmodium vivax requires 14 days of primaquine therapy to kill the hypnozoids, whereas treatment of plasmodium falciparum completed in only 3 days. So that you must have all, you know, or must have studied in the previous class. Then again, plasmodium vivax strains, they have longer incubation period. So again, these are the certain points like why we need a special strategy for plasmodium vivax. Now, what are those special strategies? It is expanding bivalent rapid diagnostic tests and quality microscopy services to detect all plasmodium vivax infections. And also ensuring compliance of the 14 days radical treatment by affected individuals, and operational research to estimate prevalence of P46-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency in that population. Now, community, what's the effectiveness of this program? And now, how do we check for the effectiveness in this program? Like surveillance in the three areas, effective active surveillance is to be carried out. It is being carried out by the trained community level health worker, that is the multi-purpose health worker or the auxiliary nurse midwives, with bivalent antigen detecting rapid diagnostic test kits. They do a fortnightly house to house visit, and then, you know, they can check for any outbreak in that particular local community. And the passive surveillance is to be done through registers that are maintained at various levels by ASHA, health worker at PHC level, at CHC, or at the district hospital level. And then screening at PHCs to be done through microscopy. However, bivalent antigen detecting rapid diagnostic test will be used in emergency situations or odd hours for non-availability of lab technician or a sample microscopy center is made functional in the areas. So, and then case screening at CHCs and hospitals is to be done through microscope only. Then surveillance should sustain monthly blood examination rate of minimum 1.5% during 2 months. Or in the category two areas, like along the surveillance has to be done in the same way as it was being done in the category three areas. In addition, more focused attention is recommended for surveillance in project areas and the construction sites and among migrant population and slum population. Again, the monthly blood examination rate should be sustained at a minimum of 1% during 2 months. Surveillance in the category two areas, category one areas, those who are in the elimination phase. That malaria should be made notifiable. Each and every case, wherever you find, whosoever finds it, has to notify it to the concerned authorities. And then epidemiological investigation to be carried out for each and every case of malaria. And then treatment should be initiated within 24 hours of detection, and complete treatment to be ensured. Detailed case investigation in the prescribed format should be carried out by the vector-borne disease technical supervisor. Multi-purpose health worker, and the case should be classified as imported or indigenous, like whether it, you know, it came from outside India or whether it originated from the indigenous population of India. This case investigation should be completed within 3 days of detection. Then contact survey should be carried out by blood smear examination for microscopy in the surrounding 50 households by a team comprising of ASHA or multi-purpose health worker. Then if additional cases are found on contact survey, the survey area should be expanded and appropriate actions within 7 days. Now this sentinel surveillance, like why do we need this sentinel surveillance in malaria, especially in this category one strains? First of all, to assess the magnitude of severe cases of malaria, and to know the patterns of severe cases of malaria, and to analyze the reasons, you know, situations which are leading to these complications, to improve referral mechanism in these areas, to improve the capacity of this medical and the paramedical staff while managing these cases, and also to improve the infrastructure in identifying hospitals for management of severe cases of malaria. This malaria surveillance data available through the routine malaria indicator survey, that is MIS report, is published every month. And then, although it does not provide the needed information of severe malaria cases, the large number of patients seek healthcare from the private sector and do not figure in the program data. Before the central surveillance system has been established in selected hospitals in high malaria endemic districts with large caseloads. SSMO, Sentinel Site Medical Officer, Sentinel Surveillance Laboratory Technician, also the Sentinel Site Malaria. The intersectoral coordination, we all know that no program can run without intersectoral coordination. A single sector cannot manage malaria on its own. We all need help of other sectors also, other departments and other ministries also. There are some of the examples of the sectors or the departments that are involved in malaria control, like agricultural sector, education sector, public-private partnership, meteorological sector. There are many you can go through there. Now the behavior change communication. Obviously, we have to increase the awareness in the community as to what we are trying to achieve, and because after all, it is for their own benefit, and then they have to be made accountable for it, and then we have to enhance their capacity building. Promote these attitudinal changes among target audiences with resource reduction, and then stimulate increased and sustained demand for optimal utilization of available healthcare services, then build support for the malaria program for partner organizations, prevention sectors, the corporate houses, party representatives, etc. Then again, this more quality assurance building service, because this won't be needed at your level. So we will skip this. Then coming on to this integrated vector management. But and why do we need this integration? So what do you mean by integrated? How is it integrated? Integrated means we are using a wide range of different interventions, like we are using biological intervention, chemical intervention, physical intervention they have proven their efficacy, and then they can be used separately or in combination so that we can implement a cost-effective control measures and then reduce reliance on any single intervention. That's why it is an integrated vector management. Similarly, as we saw the integration in the IMCI, integrated management and central illnesses. Similarly here, integrated vector management using all various different interventions. Then rational decision making process for the optimal use of resources for vector control. And the components of this integrated vector management is, first of all, first component is the indoor residual spray, which is being done with dichlorodiphenyl, trichloroethane or malathion, and a range of synthetic pyrethroids. The DTP is not used now, then it can still be used for indoor residual sprays. And this IRS strategy for areas having more than 5 months transmission in areas, two rounds of IRS with DDT or the synthetic pyrethroids, or three rounds with malathion. And for areas having less than 5 months transmission in a year, have one round of this indoor residual spray. And component two is the long-lasting insecticidal wet nets. And component three is the larval source management. Can be done chemically, or can be done biologically using the ambusia fishes and all. And then component four is the personal protective measures. Now you can see what was the impact of this malaria control program over the years. You can show that the cases have consistently declined from in 2001. You can see that there were around 2 million cases, and then came down to around 3 million cases in 2019. So yeah, there is a considerable decrease, and that's a big achievement. And so there are the current statistics. It's till 2019. You can see renal parasite incidence, site positivity rate. You can see these are the values. We don't necessarily have to remember them. At the most, you can remember about the annual parasite incidence of Delhi, which is quite low, 0.02. Still, we are getting cases of malaria in Delhi. Again, you can see this trend, like there are around more than 10 lakh cases in 2016, including 331 deaths. And from 2016 to 2020, we have reduced this number of deaths from over 300 to around 50. So yeah, there is around 6 cents decrease in a period of 4 years. So that's again a considerable achievement. So yes, with this, I would like to end this lecture for today. So if you have any questions, you may write down in the comment section, and then those will be answered. Thank you, and everyone have a nice day. Then I hope there are no questions. But sir, if you have any questions, you can revert back to anyone in the department. All the doubts will be answered. Thank you.